If we cannot rejoice in "Worthy is the Lamb" here, heaven's going to be a very, well, we won't be there. I shouldn't even say heaven will be a boring place. We won't even be there. That is the song of eternity. Worthy is the Lamb. I've entitled the message for this evening, "These Signs Shall Follow Them." The Lord says in verse 17, "And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name, by my authority, shall they cast out devils. In my power shall they cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover." Now, he does not say these signs will usually follow them. He says they shall. He doesn't say most of the time they shall follow them. They shall. And they shall follow them that believe. Don't miss that. They shall follow them that believe. Now, all the world is divided into two separate groups, and you and I are in one of those groups tonight. Those who believe and those who do not believe. Those who believe the gospel, those who believe the word of God, and those who do not believe. They really do not believe that Jesus Christ is all in salvation. They do not believe in the absolute necessity of his precious blood. They really do not believe. Now, they're the true groups, those who believe and those who do not believe. And notice it says, where our Lord says, "And these signs shall follow them that believe." They're not going to go out front. You know what goes out front? The preaching of the gospel. Remember when he said in verse 15, "Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature." That's what goes out in front, the preaching of the gospel. And don't miss this. He said, "In my name." This is so important. "And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they do these five different things he mentions. In my name." Hold your finger there and turn with me to Acts chapter 4 for just a moment. Now, Peter had been used by God to raise up to be able to walk a man who was born lame. And that caused a stir. People were upset about it because he said, "This has been done in the name of Christ." And that's what they were upset with. So we read, beginning in verse 5 of Acts chapter 4, "It came to pass on the morrow that the rulers and elders and scribes and Annas the high priest and Caiaphas and John and Alexander and as many as were of the kindred of the high priest were gathered together at Jerusalem. And when they had set them in the midst, they asked, 'By what power or by what name have you done this?' Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, 'You rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day be examined of the good deed done to the impotent man, by what means he's made whole, be it known unto you all and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of the God of heaven,'" he didn't say that, did he? It would have been true if he said that. It would have been true. But he would have been denying the gospel. Be it known unto you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you whole. This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which has become the head of the corner. And let me tell you something about his name. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. That's the name that is used for these miracles. Now, there are five miracles that he says will follow them that believe. Five signs that say this is the work of God and not our own. First, there will be the casting out of demons. Secondly, there will be speaking in new languages. Now, I realize that the charismatic movement has this heavenly language where you don't even know what you're saying. You're giving the different words and you don't understand what you're saying, but you're still edified and God knows what you're saying. That's not what the gift of tongues is. The gift of tongues, remember, he told them to go into all the world, countries that didn't know the languages that they knew. And they were given these gifts to go into another country and speak in another language fluently, and the people would understand what they said. If I have the gift of tongues, I could go into China, and maybe all I hear is English, but it's going to come out in fluent Chinese, and everyone will know exactly what I'm saying. And they had to have that to go all over the world and preach the gospel. And look what it says next. It says in verse 18, they shall take up serpents, copperheads, rattlesnakes, cobras, poisonous snakes. They'll take up serpents. And it says, fourth, if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. I mean, these fellows could drink, I've referred to this last week, they could drink a bottle of Drano, and they would digest it, and it wouldn't hurt them. I think it's interesting when people claim these supernatural gifts, I want to always say, here's a bottle of Drano, prove it. Because it says if they take any deadly thing, they can drink it and it will not hurt them. And then it says they'll lay hands on the sick and they shall recover them. Now, these men could go into a cancer ward in a hospital and they could lay their hands on those people and they would be healed. They could go into hospice where death is imminent. No hope of them being recovered. And they could lay their hands on these people in hospice and they would be healed. All of them were able to do this. And this is what the Lord worked through, verse 19. So then after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God. I want to talk about that next week. I just love the thought of that, him sitting at the right hand of God. And they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs following. Amen. Now, somebody is thinking, well, why aren't you doing that? And that's a good, legitimate thought. I can remember on numerous occasions, particularly when I was in college, I would be around these people who had, they claimed, the gift of speaking in tongues. That was the main thing they emphasized. And they would say, you need this gift. There's something wrong with you if you don't have this gift. And I can remember praying that the Lord would give me that gift if it was real. I did that on numerous occasions, praying that I might have the ability to do these things that I read of in the New Testament. And nothing happened. Was it lack of faith on my part? Well, that's what I was told. It's lack of faith on your part. Well, why am I not doing these things today? There's some who claim all of these things, except I've never heard anybody claiming I can drink poison. No, I haven't heard that. I've heard being able to speak in tongues and healing services and so on. There are even some people who practice handling snakes, and quite often they get bit with them, but they try to prove that they have that ability to do that, to demonstrate to us their authenticity. But you know, I don't claim to have any of these gifts. I'm not an exorcist. I can't cast out demons. I cannot speak in other languages. I'm scared to death of poisonous snakes. I don't even like snakes, period, let alone poisonous ones. I wouldn't be picking up a copperhead or a rattlesnake or a python or some poisonous, venomous snake. You know, it happened with Paul earlier in Acts chapter 28. Remember when that snake fastened onto his hand and nothing happened? Well, I'm not going to pick up any snakes like that, and I'm sure going to avoid trying to drink anything that's poison. Don't want to do it. And I don't have the ability to lay my hands on the sick and see them healed. I do not have that ability. The apostles did, and they went all over the globe with the gospel message, with these five signs that did follow them. They really did cast out demons in the name of the Lord, by the power of God. They could speak in many different languages. Whatever country they went into, whatever that dialect was, they would go into that country and preach the gospel to those people. They were able to pick up snakes. They were able to drink poison and it wouldn't hurt them. If they drunk any deadly thing, it wouldn't hurt them. And they could lay their hands on the sick and they would be healed. Why are we not doing that today? Now, the scripture gives an answer. The scripture does, in fact, give an answer. These gifts were transferred through the laying on of the apostles' hands. There were 11 men that had the ability to lay their hands on somebody and transfer these gifts so that they could, in fact, heal the sick, speak in other languages, drink deadly things, pick up serpents, cast out demons. They literally did those things. So when the last apostle died, these gifts that were authentic, that God really had given to them, ceased. No one that had the gift given to them by the apostles was able to transfer it to somebody else. That's what the scripture teaches. Let me show you that in Acts chapter 8, because I want you to understand with regard, because I've read where most of what is called Christianity is Pentecostal and charismatic, you know, throughout the world. That could be the case. I don't know. But let's look at this passage of scripture in Acts chapter 8. Verse 5, then Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ unto them. And the people with one accord gave heed unto those things which Philip spake, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. For unclean spirits, crying with a loud voice, came out of many that were possessed with them, and many taken with palsies and that were lame were healed. And there was great joy in that city. Can you imagine the joy that was going on with all of these things taking place? But there was a certain man called Simon, which before time in the city used sorcery and bewitched the people of Samaria, giving out that himself was one great one. I've got power that you don't have. That's basically what he's saying. I have power that you don't have. I'm some great one. To whom they all gave heed, from the least to the greatest, saying, this man is the great power of God, and to him they had regard, because that for a long time he had bewitched them with sorceries. But when they believed Philip, preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God in the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Then Simon himself believed also. It wasn't saving faith, as we're going to see, but he observed these miracles and said, I can't deny that this is taking place. Then Simon himself believed also, and when he was baptized, he continued with Philip and wondered, beholding the miracles and the signs which were done. Now, when the apostles, which were at Jerusalem, heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent to them Peter and John, who, when they were come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. Now, why couldn't Philip do it? Because Philip didn't have the ability to do it. James and John, the apostles, were sent to this place to pray for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. And that's not talking about regeneration. That's talking about the ability to perform these miracles. For as yet he was fallen upon none of them, only they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then laid they their hands on them, and they received the Holy Ghost. And when Simon saw that through the laying on of the apostles' hands, it was only the apostles that could transfer these gifts. When Simon saw that through the laying on of the apostles' hands, the Holy Ghost was given, he offered them money, saying, give me also this power, that on whomsoever I lay hands, he may receive the Holy Ghost. But Peter said unto him, thy money perish with thee, because thou hast thought that the gift of God may be purchased with money. Thou hast neither part nor lot in this matter, for thy heart is not right in the sight of God. Repent therefore of this thy wickedness, and pray God, if perhaps the thought of thine heart might be forgiven thee. For I perceive that thou art in the gall of bitterness and the bond of iniquity. Now, the gift ceased because they were no longer needed. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 10. I'd like you to see this with me. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 10. And I remember the canon of the New Testament, the canon of Scripture, had not yet been completed when this statement was made. But when that which is perfect is come. What is the one thing that's perfect? The Word of God. It's without error. Now, I realize we have translations, but the inspired original Word is without error. Now, let me remind you, everybody here knows that God created the universe. Anything less than that is irrational. It doesn't make sense. It's illogical. I know people convince themselves that it didn't happen if you go to atheism, but everybody's born knowing that God created the universe. He's so powerful that he can create the universe from nothing. You believe that. Now, if you believe that God created the universe, you can believe that God inspired a perfect book. Holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God, and he can preserve it throughout the centuries. He has done that. Now, it had not yet been completed. But when that which is perfect has come, the full canon of Scripture, all this that is in part should be done away with. It is no longer needed. You know, I would like, wouldn't you like it if I could heal people? But I can't. And evidently, it's not necessary. You see, all we need is the Word of God. All we need is God to bless His own Word, and that's all it takes. And if I think I need something else, I show I don't really believe that the Scriptures alone are enough, nor do I believe in the power of God in taking His Word and applying it to the hearts of the people and making it effectual. We don't need miracles. No one's ever believed by a miracle anyway. There's never been. If I could get up here and start doing one miracle after another, it wouldn't make any of you believe the gospel. You might be impressed with me. You'd think, boy, what? I'd like to tap into the power he has. But it wouldn't cause anybody to believe. So in that sense, miracles are not needed. Now, a man who claims to have these gifts is lying. He's lying. Let me repeat that. He's lying. He doesn't have those gifts. Well, do they think they have them? I don't think they even think they have them, because if they did, they'd go into hospitals and heal people, wouldn't they? If you have the gift of healings, wouldn't you go to the Markey Cancer Center right now and heal everybody in there to show you're able to do that through the power of God? So maybe somebody, you would. There's no doubt you would do that. But these folks who claim these gifts, they don't have them. They're liars. That whole charismatic movement, the Pentecostal movement, is not of God. It's of another spirit. And I know what spirit it is, too. Now, look what, all that being said, all five of these still follow the preaching of the gospel. Demons really are cast out. There is a new language preached that was not understood that is now understood. Isn't that so? Back to our text in Mark chapter 16. These signs still follow the preaching of the gospel, empowered by the Holy Spirit. Demons are cast out. A new language is spoken. The effects of the serpent, they don't affect the believer. Remember, Satan represents sin. He's the one who brought sin into the world. And do you know a believer cannot be affected by the effects of the serpent because they've been justified? They stand before God without guilt. There's nothing that can kill them. They're preserved by God. They drink any deadly thing, it's not going to kill them because they're preserved by God. And in the preaching of the gospel, through what the laying on of hands represents, the gospels, we're going to see that, the diseased are healed. You see, all of these things are still taking place in the preaching of the gospel. These signs shall follow them. And if we're preaching the gospel, these signs shall follow us. It will show that this is God's work, God's word, God's message, and not the message of man. Now, briefly, Satan controls the minds of all men by nature. If you are an unbeliever, Satan has complete dominion over your mind. You can't think right. You can't act right. And that is what the scripture teaches. Now let's look at Ephesians chapter 2. And see if this is what the word of God teaches. You know, Satan's called the god of this world, isn't he? He's called the prince of the power of the air. And in Ephesians chapter 2, we read, beginning in verse 1, "And you hath he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins." That describes the unbeliever. Dead. Dead. Spiritually dead. You can't believe. You can't repent. You can't love God. You're dead. Graveyard dead as far as spiritual ability goes. No man can come to me except the Father which has sent me draw him. Now look what verse 2 says. Wherein in times past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, Satan, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past, in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God. There's the difference. You were under the control. I was under the control of the devil. And somebody says, I wasn't. Well, you prove you are now by saying that. If you think, well, I'm not under the control of Satan. Yeah, you are. And you prove that by making that statement. Sin doesn't reign over me. It's got complete dominion over you if you even think something like that. You have no understanding. But God, here's the difference, who is rich in mercy for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace are you saved. You see how demons are cast out? Every unbeliever, if you're without Christ right now, you are under the control of Satan. Even if you don't understand it, even if you don't believe it, you are. You'd believe the gospel if you weren't. You'd bow the knee to Christ right now if you weren't. You'd see Christ as all if you weren't. But if you are not seeing Christ as everything in the gospel of God's grace, then you are under the dominion of Satan. Satan controls you. But God, through the preaching of the gospel by his Spirit, casts him out. The example I thought of was that demonic in Mark chapter 5. The scripture says he had his residence among the tombs. He was naked. He would cut himself with stones. People were afraid to pass by. They tried to chain him down many times, tried to tame him, the scripture says. And that's what religion does, tries to tame men. Nature, not given a new nature, just tame them, chain them down. But as soon as it happened, he'd break the bands asunder and cast off the cords. But by the grace of God, when he saw Jesus afar off, he recognized him. Now that's something that somebody God saves, that's what they do. They know who he is. They hear. He'd never come across him before, but as soon as he saw, he knew who he was. He said, what have I to do with thee? You're light, I'm darkness. You're holy, I'm evil. You're good, I'm bad. What do I have to do with you? And the Lord cast out those demons. He didn't even ask him to do it. And the Lord did it anyway, didn't he? And how did the people find him after those demons went into the herd of swine and ran off the cliff? The scripture says they found him sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed in the righteousness of Christ, is what that's referring to, and in his right mind. You see, a lost man's crazy. But when God saves somebody, they're in their right mind. They look to Christ alone. Listen to me. If you don't look to Christ alone right now is all you have that would recommend you to God, you're crazy. You're deceived. May the Lord put us all in our right mind. And then the next thing is a new language is spoken. Now, when I hear the gospel as an unbeliever, it's a foreign language to me. It doesn't connect. It doesn't really make sense. I don't see what's being said. But when God gives me hearing ears, the language that I didn't understand is a new language, the language of grace, the language of the gospel. It lines up with the character of God. It lines up with my own character. It shows me the only way of salvation. Now, I might have heard that before, and it meant nothing. Many of you, when you heard the gospel first, then God gave you hearing ears. A new language. was spoken. Number three, to those who believe, the effects of the serpent, the fall, sin, has no power. No power. All that Satan did has been undone, and every believer stands before God, listen to me, having never sinned. That's better than being forgiven, isn't it? I love being forgiven. I love being forgiven. I don't want to say something that's not right. I love being forgiven. But let me tell you something's better, being justified. See, the reason God forgives is because you're justified. There's nothing you need to be forgiven of. I don't need forgiveness in that sense. I've been justified. I stand righteous before God. That's why I'm forgiven. Because I'm just before God. All the effects of sin, the believer doesn't deal with. The effects of the serpent, it can bite me. No, it's not going to hurt me. Because I stand before God without guilt. Sinless. Holy. Listen. Holy. And unblameable. And unreprovable in the sight of God. What does sin have to say to me? Who is he that condemns? It's Christ that died, yea, rather that's risen again, who's even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. I can't be condemned. Sin has nothing to say to me. Reckon yourselves to be dead indeed to sin, but alive unto God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now that, the serpent, that creature in the garden that tempted our first parents and brought sin into the world. You know, a believer can say the wicked one has come and found nothing in me he could work with in the new man. He doesn't find anything in the new man he can even work with. The effects of the serpent are done with for the believer. And then nothing deadly can destroy them. You see, if God's for me, no deadly thing can be against me. Because God spared not his own son, but delivered him up. No deadly thing can prevent him from freely giving me all things. No deadly thing can be laid to my charge. I'm not guilty. I'm righteous. Nothing can kill me. I'm in his hand. I'm in my shepherd's hand. Nothing deadly can affect the believer. And this thing of laying on of hands, they shall lay their hands on the sick and they'll be healed. They'll be recovered. Now, this is so important. Yes, they did lay their hands on the sick. But it was given to teach not just some kind of religious ceremony that took place. You got to go back to Leviticus chapter 16 when the great high priest laid his hands on that scapegoat's head. And what took place? The sins and the iniquities and the transgressions of Israel, who could name the billions of them up to that point? They were all symbolically transferred to that scapegoat. And he was led by a fit man into the wilderness to never be seen again. But the Lord had that happen to him. God purposed it. I don't even like using the word, had that happen to him. No, God did this to him. The sins of all the elect, he was made to bear in his own body on the tree. And when he said, "It is finished," all of those sins were made not to be. And every believer stands before God without sin. I repeat, that's better than being forgiven. I love being forgiven. But if all I am is forgiven, somehow what I did is going to come back up. At some point, somebody's going to. But God says, their sins and their iniquities I will remember no more. Why? Because there's nothing there to remember. My sins were transferred to the Lord Jesus Christ by God. God's the one who did that. You know, I never will forget hearing a preacher one time, and this is stuck in my mind. I've told it to you several times, I know. But I heard a preacher that was caught up in a scandal. And he looked at his people who were bringing accusations against him, and he said, I put those sins under the blood. Oh, you've got the authority to do that? You can just up and take your sins and put them under the blood? You don't have the authority to do that. That's not something you can just up and do. The only one who can do that is God himself. And he did it. He did it. So while we do not exorcise demons the way, you know, exorcist or something like that, we don't speak in other languages. It's not even needed now. We don't pick up snakes. We don't drink deadly things. We don't lay our hands on the sick and they're healed. That doesn't happen. And somebody that claims those physical things, they're phonies. They're frauds. That's all. Call them what they are. Don't give them, say that's not loving. I remember one time somebody said, you better watch out. You're about to attribute things to the Holy Spirit that are, you're getting close to sinning against the Holy Spirit. I said, I'm not worried about that bit. I'm not. I'm preaching the gospel. And in the gospel, these things always follow, don't they? And I pray that they will follow right now by his grace in the heart of everyone listening to this message. Let's pray. Lord, how we thank you for the power of your gospel that delivers us from the dominion of Satan, that gives us ears to hear and rejoice in the language of the gospel. Lord, that delivers us from the effects of the serpent. Lord, that causes us to where we can't be killed because we have eternal life, a life that cannot die. And Lord, how we thank you that through the work of the Lord Jesus taking on our sins in his own body on the tree, we are healed. We give thanks. Lord, bless this message for your glory and for our good. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Drew.
Let's close with number 474, Only a Sinner. In the first verse, we're going to change since, the word since, to now at the very beginning. Number 474. I was foolish and sin ruled my heart. God. causing my footsteps from God to depart. Jesus hath found me, happy my case. I now am a sinner, saved by grace. Only a sinner, saved by grace. Only a sinner, saved by grace. This is my story, to God be the glory. I'm only a sinner, saved by grace. Tears unavailing, no merit had I. Mercy had saved me, or else I must die. Sin had alarmed me, fearing God's face. But now I'm a sinner, saved by grace. Only a sinner, saved by grace. Only a sinner, saved by grace. This is my story, to God be the glory. I'm only a sinner, saved by grace. Suffer a sinner whose heart overflows, loving his Savior to tell what he knows. Once more to tell it, would I embrace? I'm only a sinner, saved by grace. Only a sinner, saved by grace. Only a sinner, saved by grace.